Hello, Malty, McCallum Malt Monkeys, and thank you to Andrew from Ottawa for that malt mention, introducing Whisky Review 546. Yes, it is, because I checked. I'm Ralphie, here in the Manx Bothy, and just to let you know, we're under attack at this very moment. So I might have to suddenly grab my nautical sabre and rush out the door to help the zombies fend off the pirates who are at this very moment sailing up the middle of the Irish Sea. In case you're wondering why, this is the reason. Treasure trove. I know pirates value gold. You can look at gold. You can hold it up to the sunlight and let it glint a bit. You can swap it for prostitutes and drink and good times and all the rest of it in far-flung places. However, there is nothing compares to a bottle of fine grog. And that's what the pirates are after. My rum stash. Because they know I've got one, they're after it. So, this is my sea sabre. Yes, it is. It's a little bit long. I don't use it much when I'm up in the rigging. I tend to use my blunderbuss and my flintlock pistols, you understand, practicalities. But when I'm down in the quarter deck, and particularly on land, I find this cutlass rather useful because it keeps people at a distance while I decide whether I'm going to cut their heads off or just skewer them. Because, you know, we're spoiled with choices at times. But I do have my friends, the rum runners and bootleggers. They're downloading the cannons at this very moment with empty Lafroy bottles, which I reckon will be pretty damn good at sinking a few of these ships, these pirate ships. And also surrounding the Manx Bothy, I have a squad of zombies who are quite partial to drink. Therefore, I've got plenty of currency to pay them with, you know. And I really don't. If you know what? The pirates don't frighten me. They don't. Absolutely not. Now, you may be wondering, a whisky review and you're reviewing four rums, not just one rum, but four rums. What's going on here? What is the script, Ralphie? Well, let me explain. Back into commentary mode here. I have my cap round the other way when I'm using my sabre, you see, because it stops it getting knocked off. But when I'm reviewing, I might be mistaken for somebody else if I have it round the wrong way, so that's better, doesn't it? It works a lot better now. Yeah. So I've pre-poured these rums, and the reason's why is simple. I started recording this review 10 minutes ago and discovered I hadn't turned the sound on. And I thought, well, I'm not going to waste these rums. I'm not going to drink them all and start again because I might not be in the best of condition for presenting a rum review. So we're just going to persevere. They're poured and watered. That should speed things up a little bit and let me get this done and dusted before the pirates possibly arrive to grab my trove. Anyway, first of the trove. And I just fancied reviewing four bottles of rum at once. It just makes a change, malt mates. And for all you rum rascals that follow my whisky reviews, I hope you enjoy this. The reason for these four rums is because they're four different rums, very different rums, different flavours, different personalities, different characters. And I want to present the variety of rums out there because whisky drinkers drinking whisky all the time, it can get very serious and analytical and a little bit grumbly. Oh dear. Whereas with rum, it's fun. You see, the rum guys, they know how to enjoy themselves, kick back, you know, chill out, don't get too stressed up about, you know, the provenance of stuff and the rarity and obscurity and the all the rest of it. Smith and Cross, good start. In the British Isles, in the UK, you can buy this for £26 a bottle. Convert that to your own currency, malt mates and rum rascals. It's bottled at 57% alcohol. That's good value for money. It gets even better value for money when I tell you how good it is on the nose and on the taste. Very popular in style bars as a flavour mixing cocktail rum, but it's great straight. It's the equal to most single malt whiskies. It's a combination of Plummer and Wetherspoon distillery rums from Jamaica. And as soon as you put your nose to it, you get that Jamaican style of rum, high ester, super ripe fruits. Reminds me of Hamden Distillery, may it rest in peace. What a wonderful distillery that was. Really ripe, ripe, ripe fruit distillery. Intense, complex. There's a delicate floral note in with that dense, molasses-rich, high ester, super ripe fruit nose. It's absolute full-blood Jamaican flavoursome rum. It's been very well made. It's been beautifully matured. And I, frankly, am loving it. Reduced from 57% down to about 45%. So I've added quite a bit of water to this, and it takes it. I've not drunk much of this because I have tasted Smith & Cross before, and I really enjoyed it, which is now why I own 3 bottles of the stuff and will be buying more. Big, full, sweet, juicy cognac, almost arrival. Very sweet. Add water, it starts to get drier. It gets a little slightly more floral. But then it turns slightly sour and drier. So you get this really substantial development happening after the arrival, going into the finish, which is delicate honey-infused vanilla. There is a discreet tanniny spearmint note on the finish, which is quite engaging. In other words, it's just adding character to the whole event. And there's a clarity, despite the full flavour, despite the dense nature of the spirit, it's got a nice, clean, refreshing quality composure right across the palate from start to finish. It's top quality rum by any standard, a very good price. I suspect many people are overlooking it in favour of more fancily packaged and presented rums. I have not made that mistake. I have not overlooked it. I'm going to give it 90 out of 100. And that is a rum mark. 57% navy strength. What's all that about? Well, basically, the legend has it that at 57% you could mix the rum neat with gunpowder and you could still use the gunpowder. Now, it's not as simple as that. 57% alcohol for the Navy and a Navy contract, and they did specify it in the old days up until the 1970s when the Royal Navy, British Royal Navy, discontinued rum rationing. What they would do is they specify high strength rum because basically you could carry more and smaller quantities in the ship. Also, importantly, particularly during Napoleonic times when it really mattered, because sailors were paid nothing, and therefore just to basically keep the peace on board the kiln that was the ships, rum was a very valuable, useful commodity. The properties of alcohol, it boosted morale. It was invaluable to the ship's doctor as a disinfectant, as an anaesthetic. It's a fact. This is a fact, malt mates and rum rascals, that you had a far better chance of survival of a major injury as a sailor than you did as a soldier, because a soldier in the battlefield, if you got your leg shot off or your arm blown off or whatever, or a big hole put in you, they'd stick you with bandages and leave you to get on with it. Of course, the gangrene would set in, the bacterial infection would set in, you'd die of your injuries. Whereas out at sea, a sailor was a more valuable commodity, because you didn't need to lose that many sailors to lose control of, or lose the usefulness of a ship. You know, sailors were more valuable crew, even though they were treated like shit, as such is the custom and practice. So basically, they would ply them with rum, and if they got injured, because probably they were skilled people, would wood carvers, woodcutters, sail menders, rig dressers, all the rest of it. Splicers, splicing the main brace, one of the hardest things to do, one of the jobs. I tried it myself once, not that great, need a bit more practice. But to lose a sailor in a battle was more of a loss than losing a soldier in the battlefield. So what they'd do is, because they had tar available, heated up during the battle, if you get your leg blown off, they'd slap the tar over the wound, which of course it contains disinfectant, TCP, trichlorophenol. Tar is an actual disinfectant, so it would actually disinfect the wound and stop rot setting in, which is why after the Napoleonic Wars you would see sailors with wooden limbs which they'd probably carved themselves, and hence you have this character Long John Silver in Treasure Island with his walking stick, his elbow tucking stick in his peg leg. These aren't just cosmetic affectations such as, you know, eye patches. Eye injury in a naval battle was a very, very serious risk because of splinters. As soon as a cannonball went through wood, or even worse, if it was a tied cannonball with chains going through wood, you'd literally have a cloud of high-velocity wooden splinters, and many sailors lost their eyes. If they lost both eyes, they were finished. If they lost one eye, they had a fighting chance. Therefore, they'd get the patch over it because they would gouge, the times they'd cut the eye out under anaesthetic and literally pack it with liniment and tar. And it saved. It just basically, not very pretty, but it worked. It actually worked. And that was one of the purposes of Navy rum at high strength, was because of its multi-utilitarian role at sea. There you go. Now you know, and you won't hear that anywhere else. Next, we have Port Marant from Bristol Classic Rum. A rare example of a prominent independent bottler of rum. We've got plenty for whiskey. We've not got that many for rum. Bristol Spirits is one such company. Well worth keeping an eye on because they generally bottle good stuff. Importantly, they bottle at 46%. Rum producers around the world, please take note. Please start simple packaged, practically presented, single cask rums at a minimum of 46% at an affordable price, and you will sell what you produce. You will sell. There is now a taste, not for sweetened rums, not for the rums that get mixed with Coca-Cola and pineapple juice and all the rest of it, but for challenging sipping rums. Not many people know this, but many rums that are demerara based, that are molasses based, actually can turn out in distillation to be remarkably dry and quite astringent and very licorice. This is a good example of that style of rum. Port Marant, a couple of stills in Guyana on the Demerara River. Fascinating. I recommend when you see the name of a rum distillery, go and Google or search for an image, a picture of the stills they use, because it tells you so much about the rum that's produced, whether it be column stills, pot into pot, or pot into column into pot. There's far greater variety of still utilisation for rums than there is for Scotch whisky, by far. It's fascinating, actually. So here we are, Port Marant, very famous wooden stills. Part of those stills are made from wood. This is a classic rum in every sense. Again, Muscovado Demerara-based rum. It's from 1999, bottled in 2014. Interestingly, bottled in the UK. It may have been matured in the UK. You get quite a lot of rum matured in the UK, which actually does it a really good turn because it's cool maturation, not hot maturation, which tones things down quite a bit in terms of the vigour of the cask spirit engagement. The nose immediately is just... stunningly good, actually, for a Demerara Muscovado molasses type rum, British style rum, as against French style rum, which is more delicate, tends to be rum agricole, sugarcane juice, rather than the condensed byproduct of sugarcane production, which is molasses. If you're into rums, you need to have a jar of molasses in your house. You need to know the taste of raw molasses. It's also very good for you. They feed it to horses for their general health during the winter. Did you know that? No, you didn't. Now you do. Anyway, moving swiftly on. I took this bottle with me when I was visiting friends. We'd been out on bikes, going over hills, trailie bikes, you know, vroom vroom. And I had to ask the guys, could we leave some for my review, please? Before the pirates get it. And quite a delicate nose for such a rich, full-bodied spirit. There's a very busy nose, particularly when you add a drop of water. Don't add much. Old rums get killed by water. Just add a small drop of water. It's amazing the complexity that will arrive in what is, in fact, a very sugary spirit. And I don't mean that as a... I mean that literally. Ester notes again, rather like Jamaican rum, but different. Much more floral, more ripe, fresh fruit going on. Citrus. There is wood citrus, there is sugar citrus, there is almost a honey citrus as well. That little astringency that's running like a thick thread from the arrival through the development into the finish. The finish has the most beautiful little minty touch to it. Caramel, creme caramel and mint. Spearmint. Slightly hot mint. Mustard mint, if you can imagine that combination in the finish. Clean, fresh, beautifully made spirit. Really good by any standard. This is bloody good stuff, this. Very much. If you were to hand this to a person that really knows the rums, they would say thank you very much indeed, whiskey person. You know your stuff. A little bit of cream soda in there in the finish too. That's what I've been missing before. That's the cream soda, like American cream soda. We're going to give this... Oopsie, I'm dropping my malt mark. Oh, won't be a minute. 91 out of 100. It's a rum mark. That is for Port Morant Demerara Rum 1999 from the Bristol Spirits. Next, we're off to Martinique. Still in the Caribbean. St. James's. Rum Vieille Agricole. Agricole, rum. Sugarcane juice. If you get the opportunity to actually buy some sugarcane in the market and squeeze it out, you need to put it through a wringer. Squeeze out the fresh sugarcane juice. It is beautiful tasting. It is nothing like the refined, white, crystalline, highly refined stuff you buy in bags in the shops. St. James's, it started off as a bit of a challenge, actually, to me initially. A nice sipping rum, but over blended. Also, I did get the impression there's colour added, quite a bit of caramel added. It's bottled at 42%. It should be at a higher strength. It should be at a minimum of 46. But nevertheless, this is an interesting, engaging, complex and characterful rum, and I do recommend it. It has quite a mineral note to it. Distinctly mineral, which is what makes it quite interesting. Unlike the first two rums, which are definitively molasses based, here you're getting a different style of rum. Again, you have the brown sugar notes, you have that sugary note on the nose, but it's accompanied by so many other factors that contribute and add complexity to it, the experience just of nosing it alone. There's quite a bit of nuttiness, maple syrup, walnut, Brazil nut, and some wood spice, complex wood spice, that you would associate with cigars. Don't add much water to this, but when you do, give it a while, and you will get the most superb cognac style of flavour delivery. Delicate, but long lasting for a rum, very long lasting in the palate. And this dry note, this dry, slightly powdery allspice note from the latter part of the development going into the finish really works a treat. Touch of cola stones, powdered cola, turmeric, and coriander. A little bit of coriander, but it's slightly minty coriander. This one got off to a poor start with me, but it's catching up fast. It's a delicate rum. It's a contradiction. It's quite strong and intense, as if it's a delicate rum trying to be a big full rum, but it's neither. But over time, it's become something else. Very unusual character. You're either going to love it or you're not going to like it at all. Not a lot of room in between. But for me, because I do like more unusual flavours, I'm loving this. I'm going to give this 85 out of 100. Finally, we're going to visit Japan. Japan, not noted for being a rum producer. Whiskey, yes. Rice wine, yes. But rums, no. What a very Japanese bottle. Here it is, Royoma, bottled at 40%, aged 7 years, old oak cask. A very delicate oak, very understated for 7 years. Very refreshingly natural colour to this bottle. As soon as you smell this and taste this, it becomes clear you're not so much tasting rum, you're tasting cachaça. Cachaça from Brazil is made with rum as with sugarcane juice, but it doesn't taste like rum. And that's exactly what we've got here with Ryoma, Japanese rum. It's really kind of mislabeled. If they call it cachaça, it would be far more informative to a kind of global market. And it would, nothing wrong with that. But I suppose in a sense, rum's more recognisable with Japan, say, than cachaça. So I can understand the reason they've done it. And there's, you know, it's made with sugarcane, absolutely. Floral, delicate, honeysuckle, freesia. Very creamy and grain rich, but there's no grains involved. Very minimal contribution from the casks. The casks have matured, not flavoured. Wintergreen, spearmint. It's almost as if you combined Irish ex-bourbon cask matured, refill bourbon matured, pure pot still, with a full-flavoured rum, full-flavoured vodka, sorry, Polish vodka. This is what you're getting. But the cachaça note's quite distinctive. Very good quality, I have to add. And the most beautiful, delicate floral honey note. Restrained vanilla, slightly toasted vanilla. Hint of banana. Mountain herbs, alpine, herbal, slight minty floral note. Very unusual. As soon as you taste it, it's good quality rice wine flavour. Subtle, delicate, complex, very clean in the palate. Unusual stuff. Again, when I first opened the bottle, slightly harsh, giving it time to oxygenate, it's really mellowed it very successfully. If you're into rums, this is going to be a real novelty for you and a good quality novel to boot. What are we going to give this? We're going to give this 88 out of 100. And that is not a rum mark. It's a cachaça mark. That's what it is. Although it's called a rum. There we are. That keeps things nice and clear. Anyway, let me see if I can hear the sound of cannons firing in the background. That'll be my bootlegging rum runners firing the Freud bottles at the pirates. Yes, I can hear the sound of a few ships sinking into the Irish Sea, never to be seen again. So sad, too bad, never mind. If pirates want to attack the Manx Bothy, you know, you just got to get prepared for what's going to happen. You know, and consider themselves lucky they got bombed out of the water with empty Laphroaig bottles, because if the zombies got their hands on them, well, it would be brains for dinner. Oh, I think the zombies would end up a little bit hungry. I never get bothered by zombies because I don't have any brains, so they don't bother with me. Yeah, it's just the way it goes. You know, it's a fact. Very nice indeed. Anyway, I'll have to go now. I'll have to go now because I have to finish these off before I go to bed. I will not be wasting a single thing. Nothing goes to waste. And I've also got a bottle of beer to accompany this. Four rums and a bottle of beer. Do you know what? That sounds like a quality malt moment, doesn't it? With a twist. With a nice little rumbustious twist. Thanks for watching. I'm Ralphie. I hope you've enjoyed this four-in-one review. It's still called a whisky review because it's rum from a whisky reviewer's perspective. That's what it is. And I hope you'll join me again for Whisky Review 547, is it? Is that what's next? Yes, that's what's next. In which I will be reviewing an obscure single malt from a distillery which I haven't reviewed before. So a brand new single malt distillery whisky review. There we go. See you soon. Thanks for watching. And I hope you've enjoyed yourself, because I have.